Stop the Week with Robert Robinson.
Hello. Our conversation this evening comes from Dr. Rosalind Miles of Coventry Lanchester Polytechnic, Anthony Clare, Professor of Psychiatry at St. Bartholomew's Hospital, Benny Green, who does lots, and Laurie Taylor, Professor of Sociology at York University. And Laurie's going to choose the music. When we get to it, he'll tell us why. I see Lord Hailsham writes to Lord Whitelaw to tell him the phrase having sex is meaningless, not to say vulgar, and in redrafting the ads warning homosexuals about AIDS, couldn't they use some other phrase like sexual practices? To my ear, sexual practices suggests some curious sort of rehearsal room. And sexual union sounds like something that includes Vladivostok. I don't know. You have to choose something polite but not absurd. What do the rest of you suggest?
Anything's better than sexual relations, which sounds like an uncle and aunt when the uncle with his flies undone, doesn't it? I mean, these are our sexual relations as distinct from our non-erotic relations.
Sexual practices has, I must say, the air of this to the doctor, the air of a deviation about it. Yes. Incidentally, when doctors ask about this, great difficulty, you know, they ask about whether you've been making it, which of course is very...
Oh, no,
very
surely.
Well, they're the more
How
trendy
impudent.
Ones. The less trendy ones say things like, sex okay. The last time I heard a doctor ask that, he said, what about sex? And the patient said, infrequently. And the doctor said, is that one word or two?
Physical practices was another of Lord Hailsham's curious substitutions, and that conjures up the picture of someone hanging upside down on the wall bars. But you never know.
I think the point of Hailsham that's raised by Hailsham's complaint, maybe it is a grammatical nicety, but what it point it raises is that there isn't a fully acceptable, pretty, descriptive phrase or word to describe the function. And I think that's what arises out of Hailsham's complaint.
Carnal knowledge is also a horrible thing, which sounds like an inspection pit, doesn't it? I mean,
carnal knowledge sounds as though it contains kidney beans.
Yes, and consummate sounds more like a cookery course as well, the idea of consummating, doesn't it?
The whole problem, I think, comes down to the fact that in British English, we cannot actually talk about these things, not because we don't have the words, because we have the richest language in the world, but because we don't actually want to talk about it except in vulgar or coy or evasive ways. It's our hang-ups, not the language.
I'm afraid you're way off beam there, as we used to say in the 1940s, sitting in those American beef features. You're way off beam because this is a public statement. It's not a statement that's going to belong to anyone in particular, and it isn't coyness or shyness. It's an attempt to combine good manners with what's necessary to point out. Now, if AIDS is the Black Death, then I think our priorities are not in apple pie order if we worry too much about the vulgarities. I mean, let's get the message over this time.
Then the simplest way to do it is to do it with the grammatical error that Lord Hailsham takes such exception to, because that's why it was chosen.
But
having sex is what... If you want to do it politely, if you want to say it politely, that's the way you say it.
It's interesting. Maybe we got onto something here. Maybe different professions have the words for it. We've heard doctors quoted and schoolgirls. And I got written down in the police courts, they always say intercourse took place.
Mm. Yeah.
And there's all kinds of intercourse. We're having intercourse now, but it's not sexual.
Yes.
And it seems to me another
mission. It's a lot of fun.
It's wonderful. But
sexual intercourse, it is a curious thing. I've always thought that made it, whatever it was describing, sound like a very clumsy activity. You would need some sort of a guidebook and a backpack for.
Strange. I think this is, again, the noble lord getting this whole thing wrong. Because it really isn't a question of grammar. I mean, he may be a legal beagle, but there's nothing grammatically incorrect about having sex, because sex is not narrowly defined as meaning I'm female and you're male. It refers to all those areas of operation, and there's no reason why you shouldn't have that just as much as you have a cup of tea or have a hot water bottle.
No, it does sound a bit disagreeable. I think it's the most acceptable.
That isn't maybe an aesthetic objection, but it is not a grammatical objection.
It's especially disagreeable, I think, because it does sound as though it's, you know, a bowl of soup or something served up three times
a day. There is one other phrase we haven't mentioned, and it's interesting because I noticed that film critics, when they're talking about this event taking place, don't use the word that Laurie looks up in the dictionary, and they don't say having sex. They still go back to the old notion of making love.
And
the reason that people have... Well, we know the reason, because there's this problem about the association of having sex and making love.
Let me take you by the hand and lead you tiptoe out of this particular arena and point out to you what you already know. It's the exam and the interview season. And as a preliminary to considering that particular arcana, let me put this to you. A candidate for a place at an Oxford college was asked by his interviewer, with all that terrible depth of sincerity, what do you think you will personally bring to this university? And of course the candidate replied, my saxophone. I think the answer was more than such a complacent question deserved. But what do you think?
Well, I think interviews are a game of skill these days, and like bridge, they depend not just on being a good player, but on knowing the rules. And this is the very hard part, because the rules change with every single interview you have, because the interviewer is making the rules up as they go along. It is a formal dance. It's like a courtship. I'm often struck how often these questions asked at interview sound like the preliminary moves in the kind of relationship we were talking about just before. You know, when people say, who would you like to be if you weren't yourself? Or what would you do if you could do anything you wanted to do? These are exactly the sort of approaches that people make in very different situations.
I would ban most interviews that go on at the moment. I think that sort of most interviews are exercises in self-congratulation on the part of the interviewers. I mean, they are there for the delight and the reassurance of the interviewers. And unless you have some specialist information that can only be possibly extracted from the candidate under the circumstances of an interview, it seems to me that you can get just as good a candidate by any other method. I think that what interviews do is they allow people to perpetuate, to fill organisations with persons rather like themselves, often second-raters, and at the same time to engage in this process of self-congratulation. So many times, and I've taken part in interviews until I reached a point at an undergraduate level when I eventually said, no, I won't take part in any more interviews. It seems to me to be ridiculous, because here we are interviewing people to see if they're suitable for university. That seemed to me to be almost impossible to tell. Why not choose them simply on the basis of their A-levels, simply on the basis of, you know, what they achieved?
Once you've established capacity, and competence, you can put all the names in a hat, and if there are two places, draw two out. You never know your luck.
Well, they're the classic and characteristic and very conventional views at the moment. But take my own medical school. We're confronted with somewhere in the region of 1,000 applications for 100 places. We carve those down to about 500. We interview 250. Now, the problem, the reason that we still interview, along with 2/3 of other medical schools, is that if you do what Laurie says, across the board, there's virtually nothing to distinguish any of them. And now, that may be it. Then toss a coin. There's something rather no more scientific about tossing a coin. There's something just a little bit more personal about seeing an individual and him seeing three of the people who work in that institution. After all, it's a two-way process. Mm-hmm. You keep talking about the interview as if only one person is involved. Just one second, it isn't. Well, here's an example of what it isn't, Bob, because the medical student applicants, for example, I can only speak of them, are choosing medical schools. They have three rated on the rocker form, and they don't always take the medical school that offers a place to them. Mm-hmm. They are struck by... Now, hang on, they've read a great deal
right.
about
Thought
it.
I thought you'd finished.
No, I haven't finished, because the conventional view is the one you've just articulated. The not-so-conventional view is difficult to make. That's to say that, yes, of course it's 10 minutes. Yes, of course it can be partial. Yes, of course the interviewers can just be a bunch of entrepreneurial show-offs from an academic setting, but they needn't be any of those things. It can be a genuine attempt to personalize what otherwise is a form, is a series of statements, is a lot of rather unreliable references sometimes from school.
Well, you're dodging the issue.
Yeah, I mean,
you're conducting a public relations exercise. That's absolutely
no, I'm
fine.
Not saying
I don't mind
thing.
It. What you've got
what
to
a ridiculous statement.
Well, what you've got to claim is that the interview can find out something which cannot be established in other ways. And all I think...
Well, one of the things you can find out is if, in fact, the chap is articulate as the form says he is.
I believe that the interview is immoral, per se. In educational selection, there are other interviews. It's immoral and disgraceful because it introduces into the selection factors which have got nothing to do with the issues. The issues in these educational things are to do with whether you're brainy enough to study the subject. Now, and I don't think that anything else matters. I don't think if you've got bad teeth and a stammer, and
but
17 toes on your left foot.
This is absolutely not the case. I mean, the whole situation is that people do not come to colleges or universities and study in little boxes all by themselves. It is a community, a communal situation. And
where everyone is getting on everyone else's nerves.
Well,
it shouldn't be
speak
a, it
yourself.
Shouldn't be that.
And the
it
point
be
is that you cannot accurately assess a human being and decide on their whole future, female as well as male,
in terms
of a piece of paper. You cannot look at a sheet and say this person's got three grade A's, a day level, therefore they will be thoroughly cut out for the academic course of study. Some people are compellingly dreadful.
Wait, can I
just
say
objective
Anthony is,
what I must can ask I just Rosa, I just want to ask Rosalind this. In what academic objective other universe do you, the examiner, sit that allows you to be entirely or even nearly or even remotely objective about the suitability of the person you're meeting?
It isn't purely down to your own personal opinion. I mean, the person comes in and some of them are, as I was saying, compellingly dreadful, almost on auto-destruct, one foot in their mouth and the other on the banana skin. And by the time they've actually told you sort of 15 dreadful things about themselves straight off, you get the idea that they don't really want to come on this course, however much they have filled in forms to say that they're really keen.
Can I say on one school report, a headmaster wrote of a candidate, he will not shine at interview, but his silence denotes thought. So that the I accept that there are limitations about this, but let me just turn something back to you, Benny and Bob. Yes, in many instances, it's just a little extra. But it can be a very revealing little extra. For example, if you just rely on UCA forms, science levels, and stated interest, when you actually are confronted by an applicant to a medical school who cannot answer the question, why are you interested in medicine? Or says,
well, because surely it's the honest question is, I don't know,
really.
Well,
if he said that. And even in a sense, if he doesn't say anything, good interviewer, hang on a second, many of you make your lives interviewing. Clearly believe that it does something.
Oh, that's a different
subject. No, it's not a different subject. Why do you say that? It's precisely the same subject.
Well, because, like you, when you're doing in the psychiatrist's chair, you're interviewing someone in order to elicit interesting and entertaining
matter. And I will say that,
but you're doing a very different thing when you're interviewing someone for a medical school.
On the contrary, I want to see if it's somebody who can articulate the things that he's expressed or she expressed an interest in, who appears to have some kind of understanding of what he or she is about.
It's nothing to do with articulate.
I don't know why it's necessary, because if you rely on everything else we've got, the one thing that's missing is some kind of personal component. What I would say is that the interview is nothing like long enough. It's nothing like important enough. It's nothing like sophisticated enough. But I cannot believe that you people sit around this table and do not believe that one person talking to another for a period of time learn a great deal more about them than what's written down.
You're more a psychiatrist than I'll ever be. You must know that you can only find out one thing at an interview, whether you like the person or not.
I
agree with it, Anthony. If somebody comes to see you, I mean, and you've got to make these distinctions, haven't you? Because if somebody comes to see you and you as a psychiatrist interview them, they have come to see you because they are in some sort of trouble. And you listening to them, asking particular types of questions, are ways at getting at things that they may not easily tell you, which are relevant to the way in which you're going to treat them, to the way you're going to diagnose their problems. That's what they're there for. However, when you're interviewing them for entrance to the particular medical school, the decisions about what should count as significant things they say is unrelated, really, to what they're going to do. It doesn't seem to me that it's reasonable to take a 17-year-old person and measure them in terms of their articulacy in an interview situation, because articulacy is an important element in being a doctor. It just doesn't seem to fit, and I don't think that you believe that it does.
I didn't say that. I think it is perfectly reasonable. It is perfectly reasonable. If a young man and woman, maybe too early in age, that's another issue, to go into a medical school or another university for a subject for that matter. But it seems perfectly reasonable to me to expect that if you ask such a person who has spent 3 years slaving at A-level at a variety of subjects, it's perfectly reasonable to ask that person to explain a little about what they know about the subject they're interested in pursuing for the rest of their lives. If you get this decision wrong, they are indeed going to be the candidate.
I've never heard such irrelevant rubbish ever on this programme,
That's a large claim.
You've been listening for years.
I'm not going to say and start naming all the people that would have failed their interviews because of lack of articulacy and it would turned out to be great at their jobs. Articulacy, whatever you call it, I can't even say it now,
is
totally irrelevant to all the academic issues. I don't care if a poet can't tell me why he wants to be a poet. I have no interest in a doctor that can't say, well, I want to be a doctor because all I know is, can he cure me? But can he write a poem? None of these things can be discovered at an interview.
Benny is playing really devil's advocate. If he thinks that a doctor curing doesn't involve that doctor communicating his feelings, his attitudes, and indeed his convictions to the patient. That's why, incidentally, Benny, that medical schools have suddenly realised that the reason that so much medicine is flushed down the loos of Britain is that many doctors haven't the faintest idea how to communicate to the patient the importance of taking it. But the issue goes back to in 10 or 15 or 20 minutes. Can you elicit information which is helpful? Now, leave the universities. Go to business. Yeah. I don't know any major industry that has given up the interview. In fact, some have brought it back. And why have they gave it up in the first place? Because people like Laurie just dismissed it out of hand and seem to place their faith in things that are much more easily perverted, like what's written down, what is written down on forms. But bearing it, I think your point, Bob, is the crucial one. That there is a skill in interviewing. You've got to know exactly what it is you want.
But you totally misrepresented what I was saying. I said that I disagree with the idea of interviewing at those occasions, in those circumstances, where what can be established in the interview seems to me to have very, very limited relevance to what the person is applying for. That applies to undergraduate interviews. I am wholly in favour, for example, of interviews with people who are coming along to be teachers, to be lecturers, to take part at university, because it seems to me that these people are applying for jobs to communicate knowledge. And if you say to them, well, tell me what you would put in the first year course. Tell me what you would say here. I can remember Lord James, I'm fond of quoting, at York University, who was splendid at testing people for their honesty, because that seemed to me very important. So he would say to them, for example, what you have just said seems to me very much a sort of Socratic view of the importance of education. And if they nodded, he'd then say, but in what ways would you say it differed? And have them in that way. Or he would say to them, so what do you feel about the criminal age of responsibility? And they would bluster for a moment. He'd say, by the way, what is the age of criminal responsibility? Now, I enjoyed that thoroughly, because to show up someone who was coming along to lecture as a bluffer, as someone who lacked honesty, someone who could not communicate, was perfectly realistic.
It is if you believe that what people say is inseparable from the way they behave and what they do. All sorts of people. Yes, if it's a test of articulacy, of course, you have to see that they won't dry up, but they might not dry up in the actual situation, whereas they might dry up in the article. And people, if Lord James says it's Socratic, is it not, and the man nods because he's being polite. He may not know, but he's not being dishonest necessarily.
How many writers writers have become famous writers would have passed the fatuous test of an interview at a university?
But that's irrelevant.
It's not irrelevant. It is not irrelevant at all. It's not irrelevant at all. The point I am making is that the most articulate people on paper very often, I won't say usually, very often are hopelessly inarticulate when they are faced with an academic poseur asking them questions.
Yeah.
And if somebody like Rabelais or Lawrence Stern or James Joyce went to have an interview for a university.
But we're not actually talking about the great and the gifted and the few. We're talking about
the vast majority. Well, that's what you should be looking for in an interview.
The important thing is not just to keep it to the narrowly academic understanding of this, but taking up Anthony's point about the way the interview is being increasingly used in business and refined with a series of tests and all sorts of things, even some of them I hear going into. And not astrology and all sorts of amazing things like that, to try handwriting tests, because it is absolutely a fact that there has to be more that can be revealed about people than is available to us on the piece
of paper.
Yeah, but
I assure you, I mean, you know, leave aside the professors of codology who do all those things, read the entrails, look at the tea leaves, get an old gypsy woman in, all that patent rubbish, which I know you do not believe in. All you'll find out is if the man can do the job, whether it's reading, writing, arithmetic, or being a doctor or any other thing, give him the job, and then you'll really find out. Also, a lot of time is spent thinking, would he fit in? I know that's a rather a banal condensation of the real concern there, but will he fit in? Consider your own department or your own office or whatever. No one fits in there. They're always, as I said earlier, getting on each other's nerves. What a chimera you look for if you're searching for someone who doesn't do that, gets on nobody's nerves.
But how do you sort people out?
You can't sort people out. This is the point.
But what do you do when you've got 500 applicants and 10 places?
It's not an arrogance.
You find out who's the competent.
Then you're not sorting them out.
You do is what really happens anyway. You raffle the job. And now we're going to have some music. We're going to have some music. And Laurie, very briefly, is going to tell us why.
Yes, I was just wondering, as summer settles in and we hear all these radio announcers warning us all the time about open windows, why is it that other people's music always seems a trifle too loud? It doesn't seem to me to matter very much if it's Mozart or Brahms or your own favourite music. Even if it's nothing as compared to the noise of passing planes or boats or trains, if it's coming from next door, if that music's coming from someone else's radio, the volume's just that bit too high. In fact, other people's music seems to me rather like their nail clippings or their dirty washing. So personal, it's always a little disgusting. And as Stan Freberg reminds us in this lovely record, it's once we've become irritated by volume, by the volume of music, by the sheer quantity of noise, there's nothing that the offender can ever really do to get the sound quite low enough.
Day-oh! anyone go home?
Man, I'll have to ask you not to shout like that.
Well,
it's like right in my ear, man.
Well, it goes with the song.
Yeah, but don't holler in my ear,
well,
man.
Well, it's authentic calypso.
Yeah, but like shout. When I stand next to me, man.
Well, the shout go with the bongo drums.
Well, not my bongo drums, man. I mean, move away.
Well, I don't see why.
No. Stand over next to the guitar, man.
He sent me over here.
Yeah? Well, then sing soft, man. You know, I mean, like, wow.
Okay.
It's too loud, man. That's better.
He's a day, oh, daylight come and me one go home.
Yeah, man.
Who work all night and a drink of rum.
Daylight come and me one go home.
Stock banana till the morning come.
Daylight come and me one go home.
Lift 6 foot, seven
hold
foot,
man.
Eight
hold
foot
it, man.
Punch.
Too loud, man, too loud.
6 foot, 7 foot,
hold it,
foot,
man.
Eight
hold it, hold
foot,
it, man.
Punch.
My ears, like my ears.
Day.
No, hold it, man.
Day.
It's too shrill, man, it's too piercing.
Oh, well, I don't see why.
No, it's too piercing, man, it's too piercing.
Well, I got to do the shout.
No, man, it's too piercing, like I don't dig loud noises.
Well, you ruined the whole...
Piercing.
...record is what you do.
Yeah, well, tough, I'll take my bongos and go, man, because the whole thing is like bugging me anyhow.
Yeah, well, wait a minute, I won't shout.
No, I'm cutting, man, like I didn't want to make this gig in the first place.
No, wait a minute, I'll be soft.
Yeah? Well, then back off from me, man, it's too piercing.
Okay. How's this?
Too loud, man.
Okay.
Too loud, man. I can still hear you. Would you mind leaving the room?
Okay.
Absolutely impossible to follow that. One of the most brilliant bits of, well, verbiage. No, it's a kind of little tiny weeny 3-minute theatre, isn't it?
Yes.
Absolutely every line brilliant. I mustn't go on like this. I only ever heard it once before. What a treat. I didn't realise it was that one.
Ah, I heard you say, is this the one with two piercing in?
And that's it. Lovely. Now, we have to devote ourselves to something else, a new anthology of dreams. Do I hear you groan? Well, it reminds me yet again that buttonholing friends and telling them your dreams is far worse than showing home movies to people who aren't in them. The compilers call their book The Theatre of Sleep, a title which has the unfortunate effect of bringing on a yawn every time you think about it. Just you try it. And their literary dreams, dreams out of books or dreams literary chaps have had, and being literary chaps have turned into copy. Doesn't seem to take the curse off the things, I have to say, but now you have to tell me, why is the telling of dreams socially unacceptable?
I can't agree that people's real-life dreams are always boring. I've heard some absolutely fascinating ones. A friend of mine told me a dream of her being in a lift with her daughter, then aged 3, and she dreamed that she was taking this child to be executed. And her shrink, because they were both in analysis, these being Americans,
where'd you get this old-fashioned slang from?
This is absolutely true. Her shrink told her
that
it was expressing a fear of the daughter dying and so on. And I thought that was a load of absolute rubbish because she really hated this kid and I was quite convinced she wanted her dead and I thought her psyche was telling her something that she wouldn't listen to.
Did you explain that to her?
Indeed I didn't. I chickened out. But I thought that was a fascinating dream and I've heard a lot of good ones like that.
I'm waiting to hear what Anthony's got to say about this, but not so much that I am unprepared to speak before he does. But I think the reason that often that we don't like people telling us dreams or we're not interested in their dreams is because, in fact, they often turn their dreams into dull narratives because they believe this is the only socially acceptable way of presenting them. If they produced the dreams as they were had, if they produced more of the nature of dreaming, then, in fact, I think we would be more interested because then it comes out as experimental literature. It comes out as something disturbingly different. But if you translate them into the language of the anecdote, you translate them into the language of the little story, something that happened to me, then they do become dull because they are not narrative.
But the opposite to Laurie's situation of somebody telling a dream in a very banal, rather boring way, is somebody telling a dream, rather like some of these dreams in this collection, telling it in a very literary way, a very colourful way. There are very few people who can manage to transmit onto the written page A dream as we know dreams, as we feel dreams to be. A very celebrated example of that, it seems to be, and one which has caused endless problems in psychiatry ever since, is Freud's The Interpretation of Dreams, because that is an extremely literary work. Mm. Indeed, it is a work of great poetic imagination. The problem is that it has not been anything like as useful in terms of advancing the psychology of dreams as I think Freud had hoped it would be. And I think it's one of the reasons is that indeed he never really faced up to the problem that the dream, once interpreted and once fed back, in turn coloured all subsequent dreaming. Before Rosalind told me that the woman had dreamt of a lift with her child, I thought, my goodness, I bet that woman has either been close to a psychiatrist or maybe even in analysis. She was probably in a Freudian analysis.
What I like about, when we're talking about retelling dreams, the way several people have spoken about this, I mean, that Freud talked about it as well, and so in this book, there's an extract from Steiner talking about it, of the way in which dreams are to do with the time before language. I mean, the possibility, as it were, that these are images for which lack words. And indeed, some people have gone back to the interpretation of dreams and looked at some of those dreams that Freud reports, in particular his dream of Irma's injection, and said that in here we can find Freud talking about the dream as something which brings to us that state when there weren't words which could drop easily onto the images that we had, that to put words back onto these images, in fact, is to do a violence to them. These were images predating language.
Well, dreams do, as Laurie reminds us, exist in pictures, and although occasionally people dream dialogue and so on and so on, the minute the person actually has to pass it through the filter of language to communicate it to another, it suffers a complete distortion. And I also think, as regard the Freudian thing, what a tremendous temptation it must have been to play up to the great man. If you'd got wonderful Siggy sitting there beside your couch telling you that dreams were the royal road to the unconscious and better than free association and everything, I can't help feeling that I would be tempted to invent some wonderful dreams for him.
Well, yes, but he would make much of little. I mean, I do believe whatever anyone says in the way of running Freud down, and it's a difficult job to do, I mean, the next man you'd have to try after doing it for Freud would be Shakespeare, is that Freud is, whatever else he is not, is one of the great imaginative artists of the time, or indeed of any time. I see the doctor's making a moo of disapproval.
The difficulty is, and I think it colours all our discussions about dreams, is that, fine, Laurie introduces a fine academic point, and it's an imaginative, speculative point, and as such it passes. Yes, maybe. And Freud as an imaginative, speculative writer, fine. The problem is that he was wanting to be and insisted he was more than that, that the interpretation of dreams wasn't just Shakespeare, it was an attempt to provide a psychopathological basis for dreaming, so that there were explanations of real-life events as reflected through dreams.
But if he got that wrong, he didn't get everything wrong. We don't lose by having done it, do we?
This isn't the time or the place to talk about the standing of Freud. We're merely talking about the problem of dreams. Mm. What he succeeded in doing was persuading very large numbers of people, and this brings us back to the boar who buttonholes you at a cocktail party, persuades a large number of people into believing that their individual dreams had profound significance which could be interpreted and could tell them a great deal. We're back almost to the interview again. Instead of asking people in the interview, we should ask them what they dream. That's turned out to be
Didn't Freud try to create a kind of lexicon of dreams and symbols by which we could diagnose A from A and B from B? My point is that what is a symbol of great potency to one dreamer is a symbol of complete significance to another, that's all.
Well, I would also say that we mustn't really get too stuck on Freud, because in terms of going into dreams and their meaning and creating a lexicon and so on, the Romans were at it, and there are some wonderful examples in this book of what it means if you dream of going to bed with your own mother and all the rest of that, and what you dream. It's absolutely fascinating stuff. Who would have thought the Romans had such a rich imaginative life, just to look at their stones?
What is very unusual in dreams is for anything that would pass muster in ordinary waking life to happen. I mean, you know, William James waking up thinking he dreamt the mystery of the universe, the solution to the enigma, and finally dreamt it several times, then finally wrote it down. Of course, it was gibberish. But my friend, I make so bold as to call him that, Henry Reed, the poet and a very distinguished radio dramatist, actually did dream a formal quatrain and wrote it down. I don't say it's the best of its sort, but it's amazing to be able to dream in formal metre, because as you've just been saying, Laurie, it runs entirely counter. It goes, whenever Waterson saw anything of interest or note, he sate down at once about it and to his grandmother wrote, You should have seen this thing. It is the kind of thing I like. I saw it today from my bike. Now, Reed is the last to claim anything for it, but as a piece of a shard from a dream, it's most unusual.
Bob, I don't know if you remember, but in one of the very early editions of this programme, we were talking not about dreams, we were talking about limericks, and I said I dreamed a limerick once, and I quoted it on the programme. And I don't know if I ever confessed, but about a week later, I got a letter from a man, a writer called Leslie Charters, who wrote all the Saint books.
Oh, yes.
And said, if you dreamed that limerick, then you must have been reading my book, and he gave the title, because that limerick is in one of the books. And I had dreamed it, but I'd read it, must have read it first.
That's the Bertha Ruck phenomenon.
There's a lovely little piece about the relationship between your own imaginative life and dreaming, where that little piece about Dickens, that extract in the book, Dickens talking about being unable to evoke his own characters in the dream and talk to them,
yeah,
and talking about writers of fiction never dreaming of their own creations. Now, I thought that was fascinating, because you would have thought that the operation of imagination in everyday life was continuous with the dream world, and this lack of continuity seems to me to create the dream world even more special than one might have thought before.
Were you going to quote that piece, Benny?
Which one was
the
that?
The one that you've just spoken of. I mean, you have...
Oh, no, I mean, I don't want Leslie Charters to write again, but what I wanted to do was to read this dream analysis of Woody Allen's, because I think it finally establishes once and for all our dubious reaction to dreams. The Emperor Ho-Sin had a dream in which he beheld a palace greater than his for half the rent. Stepping through the portals of the edifice, he suddenly found his body became young again, although his head remained somewhere between 65 and 70. When Ho-Sin was on the verge of despair, a nightingale perched on his shoulder and sang the most beautiful song he'd ever heard, and then bit him on the nose. Chastened, Ho-Sin looked in a mirror, and instead of seeing his own reflection, he saw a man named Mendel Goldblatt, who worked for the Wasserman Plumbing Company, and accused him of taking his overcoat. From this, Ho-Sin learned the secret of life, which was never yodel. When the Emperor awoke, he was in a cold sweat and couldn't recall if he dreamed a dream or was now in a dream being dreamed by his bail bondsman. And I think in there is all the fatuity and all the dreary nonsense that
get. Let us soar a little after that admirable piece. Let us soar a little, because Laurie said it's odd that the writers don't dream of their own characters, but they occasionally do.
Yes,
and I'm
do.
Amazed that the anthologists here have left out James Joyce's dream of Molly Bloom. And especially, this is the sort of dream worth hearing when it turns out to be James Joyce, and the character is of sort of mythic proportions, and it goes partly as follows. I would say that it makes my scalp creep, this, whenever I hear it. I saw Molly Bloom, says Joyce, telling his dream to one of his biographers, Gorman, I think it was, on a hillock under a sky full of moonlit clouds rushing overhead. She just picked up from the grass a child's black coffin and flung it after the figure of a man. She said, I've done with you. The man was Bloom, seen from behind. And then, bending, she picked up a tiny snuff box in the form of a little black coffin and tossed it towards me, saying, and I have done with you too, Mr. Joyce.
Dr. Rosalind Miles, Professor Anthony Clare, Benny Green and Professor Laurie Taylor were stopping the week with Robert Robinson. Stan Freberg provided the musical interlude, and the programme was produced by Michael Ember.